couple places tonight. So if you have your Bible, I want you to go with me to Isaiah 54. I think a couple places. The main thought was that, and this week has been especially, just having the Lord speak hope into our recovery. And our time of struggling, even our time of doing well, because we still need to have the encouragement of the Lord to even sustain us when things are going good. Like we have to have the Lord to affirm the fact that, yes, this is real. This is real. This good thing that's happening to me in my life now, the fact that I'm turning away from some things, I don't have to be afraid that it's going to be ripped out from underneath me. The Lord has made a firm commitment to us through His Son, Jesus Christ, through the cross. And that's why step two is about Jesus. It's not, and we say highest power, I had to be real. Like, He's the only one.
Amen.
He's the only one that can cause the... Can you hear me without that?
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you so much. Anyway, let me do this, bro. So, in Isaiah 54, now, for the guys in the room, you're going to hear a lot about the reference to a woman or the woman. So don't take it as a, it's just for them night, because when you think about what Jesus says about us, we are the bride of Christ. When God talks about Israel, He talks about them being His wife. Mm-hmm. And so when we're listening to the scripture in the heart of God toward those that are weak, those that are thought of in a way that they're just not considered worth anything, we can all identify with that.
Amen.
And sometimes it's not even about what other people are saying about it. Sometimes we say that about ourselves.
Amen.
Okay. Ultimately, I'm going to say something. The accuser is really the devil. The Bible calls him the accuser of the brethren.
Amen.
And I'm going to, at the end, hopefully get to that scripture in Revelation. But Isaiah 54 says this. I'm going to start from the beginning. I might have to skip over for time-wise. But so when I'm going through scripture, I want to say this. This is what I have to tell you. You must go back and read this for yourself. And how you study the Bible is that you read the scripture in context of what's being said and who's saying it and to whom it's being said. But then you go back and read the same thing over again and say, okay, now, Lord, what does this mean for me?
Amen.
All right? So just remember that. So we're going to be in Isaiah 54 real quick, and I'm going to be in John chapter 8 a little bit, and then end up hopefully in Revelation 12. No, this is not a Bible study. This is speaking hope to us in recovery. All right?
Amen.
Sing! Isaiah 54, sing, O barren, thou that didst not bear, break forth into singing, and cry aloud, thou that did not travail with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married wife, saith the Lord. And all that says to me, in context, he talks to the children of Israel, but in talking to us, he's saying, listen, there have been just these hard times in your life when there was no fruit. There was nothing coming forth from you, but what we would consider just negative things, and there's going to be no hope, hopelessness and despair. But here God is making a statement, and by the way, this is the Old Testament that's making these proclamations, right? Now, I have to give the forethought before I get to this, which is the gospel, right?
Mm-hmm.
The fact that Jesus Christ came and He died for us.
Mm.
He took all of our sins, all of your mistakes, all that stuff. He bore it all for us on the cross. The Bible said He suffered and died. He was buried. He rose on the third day.
Amen.
When He rose on the third day, He was seen of over 500 people. That's why when you read the New Testament, you're actually reading eyewitness accounts, or Luke was one who spoke to somebody who was an eyewitness account. You have the miracles, the blessings, all those are being done 40 days. And then at the end of the 40 days, some of those same disciples that were with Him after the resurrection, proof of His life, right? They saw Him go back up to be to heaven. So He was proof of who He is. He had told them it was going to happen. He also told them, and in telling them, telling us, what's going to continue to happen. He said, when I go back to heaven, I'm not going to leave you as an orphan. You're not being left by yourself. You're not going to be lonely.
Amen.
But I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
He, not an it, not a Star Wars force,
mm-hmm.
right? Not this extraterrestrial thing, whatever we try to make it to be, some new age thing. No, He, the person of the Holy Spirit, is going to be with you, and He's going to live inside of us.
Amen.
And He's going to tell us who Jesus is. He's going to show us Jesus. He's going to point us to the Father. He's going to bring us the truth. He's going to remind us of things that God says to us, which is why when you're reading the Word of God, it's not so much that you have to remember everything. Some of you may have those kind of memories if you can. But you won't need to actually try to do that. As you're meditating on the Word of God and you're giving that, you know, that diligence, that work into your work, and you're recovering your faith, then the Holy Ghost will use those things that you've already been reading, that God's already spoken, and they'll bring it back to mind. So that's why when you're facing obstacles or you're facing life, new life situations, you're facing frustrations maybe, or you're facing just being a good place but not knowing how to handle it, the Holy Spirit allows you to know how to do well, and how to even make it when you're not doing so well. Paul said, I know how to be abased. I know how to abound. I've learned in everything, in all things. I can do all things through Christ. Amen. Through Christ who gives me strength. Amen. And so we're recognizing more and more as we're in this walk, that we can walk worthy of the Lord because he's the one that makes us worthy.
Amen.
We can walk able to overcome things because Jesus said, in the world you're going to have tribulations. Amen. Don't be fearful. Don't be upset because I have overcome the world. Amen. And if you're in him, you took logic 101, and it's like A equals B, B equals C, so A equals C, right? Yeah. It's like this logical thing that if I'm in Christ, he overcame. So that means I'm going to overcome. Sometimes you need to recognize that in yourself, that I can overcome, not in my own strength.
Amen.
Right? But by the strength of the Holy Spirit who lives in the inside of me.
Yeah.
And he's given us tools. And listen, the 12 steps are a tool for us to use.
Amen.
They're the ones that actually, to me, exposes God. It tells us how to get there. And then when the Father gets your attention by the 12 steps, he knows how to get you the rest of the way by presenting his Son.
Amen.
Because he wouldn't say to us, you can't come to me unless you come to the Son, unless he's going to show you the Son. And Jesus said, listen, I've come that you might be saved. I didn't come to condemn you.
Yeah.
I want you saved.
Amen.
Go back. 3:16, for God so loved the world.
Amen.
That he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, do you fall in that right there, that whosoever part, right, believes, will not perish. Meaning not just go to hell. Of course we're not going to hell. But you don't have to perish in a hellish situation on this side of heaven. Some of us are going through some hellish situations. And as we get closer to the holidays and all the things, there's going to be some stuff that's going to come up. But God is still able.
Amen.
The Bible says, exceeding abundantly beyond what I can even ask, think, or imagine. God can do those things for you. So he says, sing. Break forth into singing. Cry aloud. No, there was no fruit in your life, but there is now, because the fruitful one lives on the inside of us. Enlarge the place of your tent. Don't limit God. Don't limit what God can do. Don't put the fleshly limitations or the natural worldly limitations on yourself.
Amen.
The world says no to this. You're going to go to, for people say, listen, you have this record, so you can't have that. And so we allow ourselves to be limited by what other people say. Sometimes those people are very close to us and they haven't seen any good, so all they can say is, this will never happen for you. It's a hopelessness. Despair, but that's their issue.
Amen.
That's right. That's good.
Sometimes your own flesh, I said it earlier, sometimes your own voice is going to condemn yourself. You're going to limit yourself. And God is saying, I don't want you to limit me.
Amen.
I'm not asking you to do anything that I'm not going to empower you or enable you or give you the right to do. Listen, as we grow closer to the Lord, and we all in this room should be growing closer to the Lord.
Yeah.
I gotta say this about our recovery and our faith, man. You gotta be reading your Bible.
Yeah.
You gotta be spending time in prayer. If you're even working the steps, if you got to step 11, which is this November, right? Usually November is for me. It's like so you do step 11 in the 11th month, although you do 1, 2, and 3 every day. You know?
Yeah.
That's just me. I'm just saying, but it's very helpful to know this, right?
11.
So step 11 is talking about conscious contact, a continual meditation and prayer. So if you're even working the steps, if you're an AA person. And you're working the steps, and step 11 right now is what we're talking about. You're continuing on in the knowledge of God, but you won't continue on if you're not reading the Bible. You're not going to continue on if you're not in prayer.
Mm-hmm.
What I want to say to you is, like, we're in for the long haul. This is not a game. there's somebody that's trying to kill you. Just remember that.
Amen.
Not for us to be afraid, because the Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And like when I use that, it says of a sober mind. So that's a mind of clarity. The Holy Ghost gives you clarity. You look at the situation from perspective now that is not on this level any longer. But God takes you to a place where you can see it from how He sees it. You can see yourself how He sees you. And I can't get around Jeremiah 31:3, okay? Thus saith the Lord, I love you. Y'all hear me talk about love a lot, because I've just recognized, and I'm a needy kid. I need to hear him tell me that all the time. So I go to that verse a lot. Thus saith the Lord, especially when stuff is going on and I feel some sort of way. I got to go back and be reminded. Thus saith the Lord, I have loved you with an everlasting love.
Amen.
All right, so you're down, you're a little depressed. Sometimes that happens. Yeah, it's wintertime, the sun's not going to be out as much, and you got this thing going on in your body. That's all right. I've loved you with an everlasting love. That doesn't change.
Amen.
Right? But he goes further to say, and I draw you to myself with my loving kindness. So sometimes, even when I don't feel like going, I still know he's drawing me to himself.
Amen.
Because you know what? God does not want to be without you. I hope you guys seen this song. Actually, what's that? Did you sing it already? He didn't want heaven without us. What a wonderful name.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. So you need to do that too. Oh, but don't worry. Yeah, well, I won't be there tomorrow, so do it today. No, but what it's saying, just one line says that. He says, he did not want heaven without us. So he brought heaven down. And you got to understand that, because when Jesus came, he brought heaven down. The kingdom of God is with you. And when he was on his way, he said, the kingdom of God is going to be in you, talking about the Holy Spirit. So these are the promises, the inheritance, the assurance that we have because of Christ. And coming out of our addiction, and I'm saying it, I don't care if you're stuck in the middle of some stuff right now, you're still coming out.
Amen.
You're coming out of it. We're in recovery. And it may not just be drugs and alcohol. We're being recovering from a lot of stuff.
Amen.
Because some of us have layers and layers and layers and layers of stuff that needs to be peeled away and dealt with. And God is so patient.
Amen.
And he's so loving.
Yeah.
And he likes to get his work done.
Yeah.
He likes to finish it. He who has begun a good work in Ephesians 1:6. He who has begun a good work.
Amen.
I like to say it like this, because when he says a good work, I remember when people say you're a piece of work. But that's not who we are. I've begun a good work in you, and I'm going to finish that work to the day of Jesus Christ. See, he's not going to let up. Now, for some of you, that might get in your nerves, but sometimes when he's not letting up, it gets on my nerves.
Yeah.
I want to do that wrong thing. Well, no, I'm not going to leave you to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel too weak. I'm going to go ahead and do it. It's overwhelming. No, I'm not going to let it happen. Greater is he that's in you. He'll bring it. He'll bring the word. Holy Ghost will bring the word.
Amen.
Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. The devil's bothering me, he's calling me, and it'd be so easy to give in. No. Greater is he that is in you.
Amen.
Than he that is in the world. First John, I thought you were going to say it. Four. Right? Enlarge the pleasure of your tent. Let them stretch forth the curtains of thy habitations. Don't spare anything. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen thy stakes. That's like you're setting your roots deep. Because the more you're reading God's word, the more you're in prayer and meditation, it's like James calls it the engrafted word. You know, when you have a skin graft, you know, and they take it from one place to fill up the spots in the other. Well, the word of God is now coming in and filling in all those broken spots.
Amen.
Those broken places that the enemy and even ourselves allow to tear us apart. God says the engrafted word, and he says, Father, which is able to save your soul. This really is about Jesus. You can't even get around it.
Amen.
I get bothered sometimes, and we've been talking about a lot about going to the meetings, not faith-based meetings. We go to the meetings, and then somebody might want to say, hey, listen, Jesus is the one that made a difference in my life, and they say, shut up. I don't know if they actually even do that anymore. Maybe they do. I don't think they do anymore, but there's that lie that's out there. Listen, Jesus is step two for me. I'm in the room. If you ask me how I made it, I can't circumvent that.
Right. Amen.
It's Christ.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
And that's not me preaching at you. You ask me how I made it, I'm going to tell you. His name is Jesus.
Amen.
And that's it. It's a simple thing. You can sit down after that. You don't have to have a lot to say. I don't even have to tell you a horrible story. You've got enough horrible stories of your own. I'm going to tell you the good news.
Amen.
The good news. The good news, the gospel, right?
Yes.
It says, you'll break forth on the right hand and on the left. Your seed shall inherit the Gentiles. Oh, he says, and talking to the nation, he said, listen, it's going to get bigger than what y'all think it is. And when he's talking about the children of Israel, and they just think about their nation, he said, no, did you not remember what I said, that in Abraham all the nations are going to be blessed? And when you read the book of Acts, you start to see the Holy Ghost wasn't just interested in the Jews. It was all of us. And so look at your life. And really, your salvation and your recovery is not just about you.
Amen.
But it is about your loved ones as well. Mm. Because guess what? The way we all used to speak death to those around us, with Christ inside of us, guess what you start to speak now?
Amen.
Life. Amen. Guess what? You walk into the dark room now and you bring light.
Amen.
Amen.
You bring light. There's so much more in this. So you read Isaiah 54, because I'm gonna go real quick to where am I going to? Yeah, I'm gonna do that. So, alright, let me go to John chapter 8 real quick. John chapter 8. Beginning at verse 3, I'm going to read just real quick. The scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, look, master, this woman was taken in adultery. In the very act of adultery, we caught her. Now Moses and the law commanded that such a one should be stoned. What do you got to say about this? And this they said, tempting him, that they might accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he didn't even listen to them. He wasn't hearing them. So when they continued asking him, he lifted himself up. He said, okay, he that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone at her.
Amen.
And then he stooped down and he wrote on the ground again. And those that heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. Now, it's the woman here, but I want to tell you that that's us. That's all of us. That's me.
Amen.
There are many voices of condemnation. Again, there's many things that the world is going to say against you because of where you've been. God does not define us by old behaviors. As a matter of fact, he doesn't define us by our behaviors at all.
Praise God.
We are defined because of the cross. You are defined. Your new name is because of who Jesus is.
Amen.
You don't have to identify yourself. Now, I hate to go to the rooms again, but let me go to the room when we stand up and say, hi, my name is Michael, and I'm a porn addict. Or, hi, my name is Michael, and I'm an alcoholic. Or, hi, my name is Michael, and I'm an addict. I'm a drag. I'm all of these things that I keep proclaiming when Christ has said, but I have set you free.
Amen.
Hi, my name is Michael, and I struggle with porn. Hey, my name is Michael, and I struggle with alcohol. Hey, my name is Michael, and I'm in recovery from drugs and alcohol, and whatever else you want to think about. Key thing, that's who I used to be.
Amen.
That is not who I am.
Amen.
Amen.
That is not who I am. Now, these men were condemning this woman. I got to say something about this one second. You go read this for yourself, too. But it's really funny, you know, they said they caught her, you know, in the act of adultery, talking about the law of Moses, right? Well, the law of Moses actually said that you caught the man and the woman, and you brought them both, right? So.
Tell them.
Well, yeah. But I'm just saying, you know what I mean? So where was the man? I wonder if maybe he was among the men that were trying to throw the stone.
Amen.
They went on, it can't go. That's speculation on my part, right? Here's the key thing. Even if the law is written against us, guess who died?
Amen.
That we wouldn't be condemned by the law.
Yes.
Jesus.
Amen.
That's right. And you know what he did while he lived on this earth? He fulfilled the law on our
earth. Thank you, Lord.
That's what the Bible says. And so when we're walking this earth, I don't have to walk under condemnation. There is therefore, the Bible says it, Romans 8:1. There is therefore now, sorry, there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus, walking after the Spirit and not after the flesh. I'm not living a fleshly lifestyle. Doesn't mean I don't fall.
Amen.
Doesn't mean I don't sin. I am not sinless.
Amen.
I'm not. The only sinless man on earth is Jesus Christ himself.
Thank you, Lord God.
Amen?
Amen.
But if you follow Jesus, if you're doing step 11 in truth, then you will sin less.
Amen.
The likelihood of relapse happening will be less because you're spending time with Jesus.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you something. When you're with him and you're starting to love him, like Jesus said we should love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbors ourselves. If that really is going on in our hearts and our lives, our minds are being overtaken with that, then those other loves, and they used to be loves,
amen,
they pale in comparison. I'm going to tell you something. The longer you're walking with Jesus, the less you're going to want to partake of some of that stuff over there, because you're going to start noticing, when I do that, it messes up my fellowship.
Amen.
Now, I got the relationship. Now, I got five kids, and they're mine. I'm their father. That's a relationship that's established. And most of the time, we have good fellowship. Now, I can sin, and they can sin. It can mess up the fellowship, right? But what we're learning, as they're adults now, and I want to continue to be with them, we stop doing those things that are hurtful to one another. Take it out of the human range and you start to recognize, I want to stop doing those things that are hurtful to my God.
Amen.
Because let me say something. God hates sin, but he loves you.
Amen.
Amen.
And he sees sin as an enemy. He sees sin as the very thing that he had sent his son to die for. So when sin is in our lives and it's capturing us and it's embracing us, it's like a man watching his wife being seduced by an enemy.
Yeah.
And God's heart is broken for that.
Yeah.
And so as we're growing closer to the Lord, God, I don't want to break your heart.
Amen.
Because your heart is for me. They all walked away with the conviction of their conscience. Jesus was with them. It's good to be left alone with Jesus, by the way. Let me just say that.
Amen.
When Jesus had lifted up himself, he saw nobody there but the woman. He said to her, woman, where are your accusers? Has anybody condemned you? He said, no, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I. But listen to this. Go and practice sin no more.
Amen.
The more you're loving him and being loved by him and responding in that fellowship because of the relationship that is the foundation, yeah, we will sin less. There are going to be new things that are going to come up in your life that have nothing to do with drugs or alcohol or porn. It'll be about something different. It'll be an anger thing now that God wants to hone in on and cleanse us of that. It'll be an obsessive disorder thing that we might be having to go through. But God reveals these things not to condemn us, but that we may be made whole. If he doesn't point it out, then we don't know it's there, and then we can't get well.
Amen.
We get to that place where 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, our faults, those things that are wrong, he says, okay, confess it. That means agree with me that it's wrong. Agree with me that you got this problem. I already know it anyway. I want to have that discussion with you. I want you to acknowledge this is my truth. Confession, yes.
He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins
and cleanse us
of all unrighteousness.
Mm-hmm. That's what God said he will do. That is a promise. And we can all walk in that. We can all walk in the truth of his love. We can all walk in the truth of being holy because he's holy. That's the Bible. I'm not making this up. You can read this. This is real. He wants us to understand and walk in the truth. He wants us to be free. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There's liberty. There's deliverance. There's healing. These things are ours because of who Jesus is. Not because of me, but because of who Christ is.
Amen.
Let me go real quick and close up at Revelation chapter 12. Because he set this woman free. In the Old Testament, he's letting the woman know, listen, yeah, you were a widow, yeah, you didn't have any kids, but let me just tell you, now you can be fruitful in your life. He's telling us, yeah, there was times in your life and it was just all negative things going on. There was nothing good to be said about you, but now, because of Christ in you, the hope of glory, there are good things to be said.
Amen. Amen.
Good things to be experienced. Good things to be lived out because of Christ. Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now, I love this part. I always love the present tense, now. It's like Jesus say, I am. That's not just the present tense. It's always there, I am. Now, is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. Listen to this. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Talking about the devil, he's been cast down. Amen. So guess what that means? Anybody that's in agreement with him has been cast down. Because guess what the Bible says about the cross? First of all, Jesus was manifested to destroy the work of the devil.
Amen.
Our sins have been forgiven. We've been made clean. See yourself as one that's been made clean. Do you see yourself as that? Do you see yourself as one that's been made clean? Here's how they overcame. Verse 11, I'm going to let you guys go now. They, or we, overcame or overcome the enemy. Overcome our flesh. Overcome the world. By the blood of the Lamb. By the word of their testimony, or our testimony. Our testimony becomes a word of hope now. Our testimony is that somebody will say, I've been clean for 5 days. Feel good. There's something going on. I know it's bigger than just a physical thing. Especially knowing that you're in Christ, it's only a continuation of good things that are going to occur.
Amen.
Listen to what I'm saying. Bad things are going to happen, but the good things will overshadow. Just like light overshadows darkness. Funny word to use about light being a shadow, but it actually does. It just closes the darkness out. It exposes darkness. It can't be there. It's light. Even a little candle in a dark room.
Amen.
Right? They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. That's the cross. That's Jesus. That's our way in. By the word of their testimony. And listen to this. And they loved not their lives unto death. That's step three, actually. I'm not any longer trying to do it my way. There's no more manipulation about getting my way done.
Amen.
Step 11 says this. We're praying for his will and the ability for it to be carried out. Listen to what I'm saying. His will. Jeremiah 29:11.
Amen.
Thus saith the Lord. I know the thoughts I have for you, saith the Lord. And they're good.
Amen.
I got good things for you. I am not trying to hurt you. There's one that does that. But again, he's been cast down. And there was an expected end. God's heart toward us is good. God's intent toward us is good. Jesus' way in our lives is perfect.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you tonight, again, for just a reminder of who you are. It is an awesome thing to recognize, God, that you are completing yourself. You didn't need us, but you wanted. Said you didn't want heaven without us. You could have all of that. It's you, but you didn't want it without me being there with you, Lord. Without us being there, so you came, Jesus, and you're still coming. Holy Spirit, I pray for every man, every woman in this room. God, you need to attack our hearts. You need to attack our hearts, God. Be pervasive. Paul said, I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which is committed unto him against that day. Persuade us, Lord God. You're worthy of our praise, our adoration, our obedience. You're worthy of the struggle, God, because you bring us through even that. Thank you so much, God. For your word, for the right to pray, for the right to experience your presence, God, and the hope of heaven, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the hope of heaven, we'll have new bodies, a perfect body, in a perfect place, with a perfect God. Thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Good job, Mike. Good job.